She could pull herself up on that swing, her full body weight with her two hands.
Hello and welcome to True Crime Rocket Science, the most authentic voice in true crime. Today's day 66 since 5-year-old Summer Wells disappeared. In this episode, we're going to look at 6 new insights from the Sermon on the Mount. Bear in mind, this is episode 5 in the series analyzing the Sermon on the Mount, and there will be probably 2 more episodes on the Sermon on the Mount after this one. I also want to draw your attention to a video by Crime Stories Obsessed dealing with Summer's teeth. I'll put a link to that in the description. And what I think that addresses are issues of potential neglect. I think one area where we can be quite neutral about the topic, but regarding everybody, all of us, is how do we deal with our teeth? How do we look after our own teeth? And that is often a symptom, not always, but often a symptom that, how much we take care of ourselves and to some extent others. I've also come across 1 or 2 additional images of Summer clinging to Robin, which I thought were quite interesting. I'll put a link to that in the description as well. Before we get to today's episode, and as usual, I will play clips out of the Sermon on the Mount to illustrate what I'm saying. But if you haven't subscribed, please do. You can click on the light blue icon on the bottom right of your screen. Like, share, leave a comment. Bear in mind, there'll be a live dealing with your best questions this coming Sunday, probably at 2 o'clock Eastern Standard Time. And let's get started.
She give him a run for her money every day.
A run for her money. Now, another channel covering the Summer Wells case has recently put up a video about Candace becoming tearful at a prayer vigil. In any event, at about 7:23 in the Sermon on the Mount, in other words, roughly halfway, Candace chuckles as Don says she'd give him a run for their money every day. I don't know what to make of that, really. I suppose it's the context that's baffling. They're sitting down to go on national television to talk about Summer, and Don's talking about giving them a run for their money. According to the Merriam-Webster dictionary, the saying to give someone a run for her or his money means to make it difficult for someone to win a game or contest by trying hard and playing or performing well. The day that the Wells couple sat down for the Sermon on the Mount was actually close to the same day or just after the authorities announced that they were scaling down the search. So in a perhaps a symbolic way, in a sense, the authorities were saying, kind of, we give up. We don't know. We haven't been able to find Summer, and we're going to sort of stop looking for her. I'm not saying that that is what happened, just that effectively, by announcing that they were scaling down the search, basically 2 weeks after her disappearance, whoever was responsible, may have had a sense that the search was given a run for their money, right? That the search failed, and whoever did whatever they did got away with it effectively. Certainly at that point, certainly that's how it appeared. Now, interestingly, news reports from June 28th, the same day as this interview, referred to crews scaling back search for Summer Wells. Also, Summer Wells' mom says she fears her girl was lured away. Also, mother of missing 5-year-old Summer Wells speaks on daughter's disappearance. All of those events happened on the same day that the crews apparently scaled back the search. You didn't hear any appeal during the Sermon on the Mount, please don't stop searching for Summer. In fact, you actually heard Don saying that he felt sorry for them, that he saw them limping around, right? It was kind of a sense of thanks a lot, no need to continue kind of thing. I do think it's possible that Don, despite talking about Summer giving her older brothers a run for their money, was actually conscious of this idea of giving the searchers a run for their money. I'm just saying, I think it's possible that psychology was circling in his brain. Interestingly, a reward fund was actually set up the same day as the Sermon on the Mount as well. And there's an article dated June 28th, reward fund created for information in Summerwell's case. In general, though, I'm not sure if Summer did give anyone a run for their money. I mean, take those words literally. Did Summer give anyone a run for their money? Her oldest brother was more than twice her age, and even in Candace's own accounting of events, Summer never really swam or played with any of her brothers on the last day she was seen. You know, could Summer speak? And so that brings us to the second point. Summer was the boss of the family.
Typical girl.
And they get on.
So at this point, Candace interrupts Don. And bear in mind, when she's speaking, she seems a little bit slurry. And so one's got to bear that in mind, given what she's saying. So Don is actually trying to sketch a portrait of the kids interacting, and he describes Summer suddenly wordlessly appearing and wielding a stick against the boys. And that it's at that point that Candace interrupts him at 7:39 to say Summer was the boss of the family. Now, I also don't really know what to say about that. On the one hand, Summer using a stick instead of words is interesting. On the other hand, it's difficult to imagine this vulnerable child exerting much power at Chalet Wells. I mean, consider where she was sleeping every night beside her father since the day she was born. How does that make her the boss of the family? And we do know, we kind of get a sense that Don rules Chalet Wells like a Tyrannosaurus Rex. You know, he's bigger than anyone else there. He's the patriarch. He's in control of everything and everyone, isn't he? Perhaps Candace felt that Summer was favored, and so if the Tyrannosaur favored Summer, then she effectively did run the place. Even if that were true, it's hard to believe Summer exerted much authority when Don wasn't around. And if there's anything to her being verbally impaired, it just makes it seem even less likely. I think another way to think about it is, if Don and Candace weren't around, do you really think Summer would have been the boss of the family, including of her brothers? In the last photo, Summer hardly seems to be giving anyone a run for their money or being the boss to anyone. Instead, she seems at risk. She seems in jeopardy.
Typical girl.
And they get on a line.
So at about 7:44, Don interrupts Candace to call Summer a typical girl. Do you think that was true? Was she a typical girl? We've already discussed how unusual her behavior was in church, and Sally Talusi made an excellent point in the previous video that if Summer actually made it to school now, her developmental issues would come to the fore immediately and probably painfully. And so, I mean, that would raise this question, almost turn it into a rhetorical question. You know, is this a typical girl? Was Summer a typical girl? Was she being raised in a typical way? Was she being cared for in a typical way? Was the family fabric typical?
Good girl.
When they get on a line, she'd put them in line.
So this is at about 7:45 in the clip. Candace says this with some conviction and some, looks like, satisfaction. They get out of line, she'd put them in line. There's kind of a slight smile on her face. What's interesting is that there's not really a sense of intervention. I'm talking about within their own version of events. There's no sense of Candace intervening to protect the little girl, or Don doing the same to protect his daughter. According to this anecdote, Summer's got to protect herself. Or you just have a sense that Summer's so effective at protecting herself, she can, you know, pick up a stick and brandish it and so on. And you almost get the sense from this story that the boys need protection, which is obviously absurd. But I mean, it's sketching things in a way that is an inversion, I believe.
You know, she loved to run. She just loved to run, you know.
Now take a look at the deer in the headlights look Don gives the camera at 8:11. He looks directly into the camera. This is usually significant. There are often cases where you will see suspects or people of interest or whomever. It could be politicians, but what you sometimes notice is they will give an interview and at a certain point they will look directly into the camera. And it just shows then there's a sense of alertness that they not only aware of what people are thinking, but also perhaps want to emphasize the point or are perhaps concerned about something. Again, I'm not quite sure what to make of him saying those words. She loved to run. I suspect, and this is obviously conjecture, it's not necessarily that significant, but perhaps he's aware of this thing that is raised twice on two occasions earlier in the Sermon on the Mount that is used the past tense. And you kind of get the sense that he's kind of caught himself out doing it and glances at the camera, but this time doesn't verbalize the fact that by saying she loved to run, he's now, you know, made another error there. Now, you might not think very much of that, but consider the scenario from the perspective of a parent who's genuinely concerned about their child in these circumstances, wants to go on national television to talk about them. Well, why on earth would there be the skittish sense about saying that she loved to run or that she loved to do this or that? Why would you glance at the camera with that sort of look in your eye, that sort of nervous look? Why would there be any reason to feel nervous about those words? Now, if you're saying, well, that's neither here nor there, I'd be inclined to agree with you, but not on the sixth and final point, which I think is very significant and possibly the most significant of the entire Sermon on the Mount, right?
She could pull herself up on that swing, her full body weight with her two hands.
So on both this point and the previous point, I found Don's body language to be quite interesting. First of all, him looking at the camera and then him gesturing towards the swing. This is at 8 minutes 14 seconds. So Don points to the swing and says she could pull herself up on that swing, her full body weight with her two hands. As he says this, in which direction is he looking? So it is quite interesting just looking at Don when this is going on. And, you know, in the context of true crime and someone disappearing, talking about body weight or full body weight is potentially very significant. I know when I was researching another case, I went to the grocery store to buy a full chicken, cooked and still warm in a plastic bag. And the idea was to see how this triggered me. So what I found was I noticed I could smell what was in the bag, even though it was sealed. And also that the bag, though quite small, felt heavier than I expected. I did have the sense that I was carrying this, what used to be a chicken, in this bag. And I felt how heavy it was. I guess what I'm trying to convey is I was trying to intuit the intertextuality in this kind of scenario, if you get my drift. And so within the intertextual framework, I felt conscious that I was carrying the full body weight of this chicken. If someone did dispose of Summer somewhere during that exercise, that procedure, if that procedure took place, there was likely a moment of lifting her in and out of a vehicle and transferring her somewhere else and an appreciation of her full body weight. During this procedure, someone would have experienced her full body weight for the last time. Who do you think that was? I just want you to be aware that in the context of this Sermon on the Mount, of all the things that they can talk about, of all the words and statements and idioms that can come up, there are these statements such as giving her a run for her money or giving them a run for their money and full body weight, right? What does that mean and where does that take us? Well, that is the critical question. So I'm not going to take it further than that. If you're listening to this as a premiere, consider donating a super chat. I will be back on Sunday to deal with your best questions. So I have kind of made a list of some of the most important and intriguing questions from your perspective, and I'll be dealing with them on Sunday in a special live stream. I'll obviously also be dealing with your questions during that live stream. So if you have any thoughts on summer wells between now and then, you might want to write them down, and I'll then try and address as many of those as we can. Wherever you are in the world, stay safe, have a good weekend, and I'll see you guys next time.